Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to prove the law of large number. Both theorems, you have two versions, the weak law of large number and the strong law of large number. I'm going to prove both of them. And I'm also going to tell you a little bit about another stronger result called the ergodic theorem. So, in the context of the law of large number, we are dealing with a sequence of random variables that we assume to be independent and identically distributed. We also assume that those random variables are integrable, so meaning that their expected value is finite. So I'm first going to write this, that's kind of the framework. So let xi be independent and identically distributed. Okay, so identically distributed means that those random variables have the same distribution, or you can think same distribution function. And so in particular, this means that all those random variables have the same mean, okay? They have the same expected value, and I'm going to call the common value of their expected value mu. So xi, expected value of xi is going to be equal to mu, and in the theorem, we need to assume that mu is finite. So now, both versions, weak and strong versions of the law of large number, deal with some object, random object that I want to call the empirical mean. So let's assume, for instance, that you can observe the first n of those random variables. And so you are going to add them up, divide by n, and that's going to give you the empirical mean. So that's kind of some kind of average that you can observe. So that's going to be this quantity, x1 plus x2 and so on up to xn. And then we look at this divided by n. So now it turns out that for all n fixed, this object, the empirical mean, is again a random variable. But something that is very remarkable in the law of large number is the fact that as n increases, this random variable, I want to say, becomes less and less random and more deterministic, at the point that in the limit when n goes to infinity, in fact, you have convergence not to a random variable, but convergence to a fixed number. And this fixed number is just the theoretical mean, the expected value of those random variables itself. So here you have a convergence as n goes to infinity to mu. So as n goes to infinity. And so that's basically the conclusion of the two versions of the laws of large number, weak and strong. So now in the previous video, we defined different types of convergence, and that's the difference between the weak law and the strong law of large number. Now, to be more precise, I need to explain which type of convergence we have here. And so in the case of the weak law of large number, like this theorem state that this empirical mean is going to converge to the theoretical mean mu in probability, while the strong law of large number tells us that we have the same convergence, but in fact, almost surely. And so indeed, in previous video, we proved that convergence almost surely implies convergence in probability. So indeed, the weak law of large number is indeed a weaker result than the strong law of large number. Now you see that I didn't write any assumption about the variance of those random variable xi, and in fact the law of large number holds even when the variance of the xi is infinite. However, in this case, the proof is based on martingale theory. That's another of my playlists. And here I'm not going to use martingale theory, so to prove those two versions of the theorem, I'm going to assume that those random variable xi have just a finite variance. So first, let's prove the weak law of large number, even if we don't need the weak law of large number to prove after the strong law of large number. I'm just going to do as some kind of warming up, because similar techniques appear in both proofs. So the idea here to prove convergence in probability, so here I'm just to shorten the notation a little bit. I call Sn the sum of the first n random variable, and then we are looking at Sn over n. This converges in probability to the expected value of the xi. So to prove this result, that's a convergence in probability, we can use Chebyshev's inequality. So to apply Chebyshev's inequality, so the idea is to look at this random variable minus mu, the probability that the difference is larger than epsilon, we want to prove that this probability goes to zero. So step one is to observe that indeed the expected value of this random variable is equal to mu. That's clear. Sn is the sum of those first n random variables. By linearity of the expected value of the sum here is equal to n times the common expected value, which is mu. But you divide this by mu, that gives you n mu divided by n, that's again equal to mu. So indeed, we have that the expected value of Sn over n is equal to mu. And then to be able to find a good bond in Chebyshev's inequality, we also want to find the variance of this random variable. So here, we are going to assume, to be able to prove the result, we need to assume that the variance is finite. So I'm going to write that the variance of all those xi is equal to, let's say, sigma square. And so sigma square is finite. And so under this assumption, we have that the variance of this empirical mean, Sn over n, so the 1 over n can go outside the variance, it becomes say 1 over n squared. So this is equal to the variance of the sum, variance of x1 plus x2 up to xn, divided by n squared. Now, because those random variables are independent, the variance of the sum is equal to n times the variance of the common variance of each of them. And so this is equal to, the numerator is equal to n times the variance of xi, that's n times sigma square, so n sigma square, but divided by n square. And so this is equal to sigma square over n. And that's in this calculation of the variance that we kind of understand why there is this convergence to a deterministic number, why this random object becomes more and more deterministic as n increases. If n is large, you don't change the expected value, but you see that the variance is affected and divided by n here. So that means that as n increases, the variance here is going to decrease to zero. And so indeed, this object becomes more and more deterministic. That's kind of the spirit behind the law of large number. So now, how can we conclude from those two things? Well, to prove convergence in probability, I need to prove, to look at the limit when n goes to infinity of the probability of, so the difference between those two random variables, except I'm intentionally use the word random variable. Normally we look at the absolute value of xn minus x, let's say. Here we have sn over n, that's indeed random, but this one is deterministic. So sn, so we have sn over n minus mu, okay? And we want to look at the probability that this is larger than epsilon, and we want to prove that to have convergence in probability, we want to show that this limit is zero. Well, to prove that the limit is zero, that's easy. The goal is just to use Chebyshev's inequality. You see that this one is going to be less or equal to the limit when n goes to infinity of, so we saw that indeed this mu here is equal to the expected value of Sn over n. So indeed we are in the context, in a context where we can use Chebyshev's inequality. We look exactly at the probability that a random variable deviate from its mean by more than epsilon. And by Chebyshev inequality, that should be less than the variance of Sn over n divided by epsilon squared. But we saw that the variance of Sn over n is equal to sigma squared over n. And so eventually, here we end up with a limit when n goes to infinity of sigma squared divided by n epsilon squared. Okay, so now we assume that sigma squared is finite. We want this also for all epsilon strictly positive. So sigma squared over epsilon squared is just a fixed number here. And of course, when you take the limit when n goes to infinity, this is equal to zero. Okay, so conclusion, we indeed have that Sn over n converges to mu in probability. So now let's prove the strong law of large number. So again, the assumptions are the same, but now the conclusion is stronger and we have a convergence almost surely instead of just a convergence in probability. So I rewrote the statement here. We look at the strong law of large number. Now we want to have a convergence almost surely. So here the spirit is step one to prove a convergence, in fact, almost surely of a subsequence, and this subsequence is going to be Sn squared divided by n squared. So we are going to first prove convergence almost surely of this subsequence, and to prove this first step, we use again Chebyshev's inequality, but also the first Borel-Cantelli lemma. So now the reason why we take n squared instead of n is to decrease the variance enough so that some infinite sum of probabilities is finite and so that we can indeed use the first Borel-Cantelli lemma. So that's kind of the spirit of the proof. That's step one. Step two is just some basic algebra. That's not very difficult. So first, let's see that indeed, even if you change the value of n, the expected value of this random variable is again mu. So we are in the context, I mean, that's something we need to have in mind to be able to apply Chebyshev's inequality. Now, let's look at the new value of the variance. If we look at the variance this time of Sn squared divided by n squared, so again, this n squared goes outside the variance, but now we need to multiply the degree by 2, so that becomes an n at the power 4. And then this Sn squared is the sum of n squared random variables that are independent, identically distributed. So by independence, that's just equal to n squared times, by independence, that's equal to the sum of the variances. But because the variance is the same, that's going to be n squared times the common variance of those random variables. So eventually, the variance here is equal to this n squared. Here I'm using independence and the fact that they're identically distributed times the common variance of those xi divided by n at the power 4 that comes from this n squared here. You have obviously simplification, that's 1 over n squared. We use the notation sigma squared for the variance here, and so eventually this is equal to sigma squared divided by n squared. So now let's apply exactly like before Chebyshev's inequality, but now instead of looking at this random variable, we are going to look at that one. So now we have that the probability that Sn squared divided by n squared minus mu is larger or equal to epsilon. Epsilon can be any positive real number. So by Chebyshev's inequality, that's less or equal than So the variance of this random variable, that's this quantity, divided by epsilon squared. So eventually we end up with this probability being less than sigma squared divided by n squared epsilon squared. And so that's of the form sigma divided by n epsilon squared. Okay, so same result as before, except that now instead of having this sequence of random variable whose variance is of the order of 1 over n, now we have a 1 over n squared here. And so if I add up all those probabilities for n going from 0 to infinity, then I have indeed an infinite sum that is finite. And why do we need that? Well, we need that to be able to use the first Borel-Cantelli lemma. So I'm going to write that. So now if I take the infinite sum here, so we look at the infinite sum for n equals 1 to infinity of those probabilities, then that's less than, remember this term, I'm just going to write the sum, that's the sum for n equals 1 to infinity of sigma over n epsilon squared. Okay, so if we had a term of the form 1 of the order of 1 over n, then the sum would be infinite. But because the term now behaves like 1 over n squared, this infinite sum is finite. So this is finite. And so from the first Borel-Cantelli lemma, what we can deduce, so I'm going to write BC1 for Borel-Cantelli lemma number 1, we know that those events, so you can think of that as event AN, let's say, this implies, the fact that the sum is finite implies that the probability of the lim sup of those events is going to be equal to 0. Now, remember also from a previous video that the lim sup of a sequence of events is exactly the new event that infinitely many of those events occur. And so from that, we can conclude that the probability that Sn squared divided by n squared minus mu larger than epsilon. So I'm going to write infinitely often. So here, by infinitely often, I mean the event that this is larger than epsilon for infinitely many values of n. So this probability is equal to 0. So that's again a consequence of the fact that this sum is finite and the first Borel-Cantelli lemma. So now, from this, we can deduce convergence almost surely of the sequence Sn squared over n squared. So let me do this. Now, if we look at the probability that Sn squared over n squared does not converge to mu, and we want to prove that this probability is 0, so let's look at the probability that the limit when n goes to infinity of Sn squared over n squared, and we want to look at the probability that this limit is different from mu, okay? Then, saying that the limit here is different from mu implies that there exists epsilon positive, okay, such that this inequality occurs infinitely often, okay? Then, so again, this probability is less than the probability of this event if we inject here one more condition, which is there exists epsilon positive, but because epsilon is, because Q is dense in R, we can assume that epsilon is a rational number. So what I'm saying is this event implies that this should occur infinitely often for some epsilon rational number, a positive rational number. And so that's exactly the probability that becomes the probability of union of those events, which I can bound by the sum of the probabilities. Why do I still have a sum? That's because I force epsilon to be a rational number so that indeed I have a countable union of events, but a countable union of events that have probability zero, again, has probability zero. Okay, that's kind of the spirit of the proof. So now I can say that this is less or equal to the sum for epsilon in Q plus, let's say, so Q plus is just notation I use for a strictly positive rational number of the probability of this event. So probability that Sn squared divided by n squared minus mu is larger than epsilon infinity often. Again, that reads if the limit here is not equal to mu, then there exists epsilon rational number strictly positive such that this difference is larger than this epsilon infinity often for infinity many values of n. But we just proved that this probability is equal to zero for all n. So if here what I have is like a countable sum of zeros, so again, this is equal to zero. Okay, so that completes the proof of like step one of the proof of the strong law of large number. What we have is that the probability that Sn squared divided by n squared, probability that the limit is not equal to mu is equal to zero. And so that means that indeed Sn squared over n squared is going to converge to mu almost surely. Okay, so that was the first step. We almost get the result. Now we have one more little thing to do to conclude. So let me write this first result that we were able to prove here. What we have is that Sn squared divided by n squared converges to mu almost surely. Okay, so then next step is to just prove that for values that are between perfect squares, we still have convergence almost surely. And the way we do that is by comparing such terms. So let me now fix k, that's just an integer. So fix k in n, that's an integer. Then there is a unique n, such that k is between n squared and n plus 1 squared. Okay, so I'm going to fix n such that when we have that, let's say n squared is less or equal than k and strictly less than n plus 1 squared. And now, what I want to do is ultimately to prove that Sk over k is going to converge almost surely to mu. And to do this, I'm going to use this, and also I need to compare Sn squared over n squared and Sk over k. So let's look at this new ordinary variable. So Sn squared over n squared minus Sk over k. And then it turns out that, well, this quantity is of the order of at most 1 over n, okay? And so when k goes to infinity, and so n also goes to infinity, this should go to infinity. That's going to go to infinity very quickly. And so to see this, the idea is just to use the triangle inequality and break this down into two pieces. So I'm going to say that this is less than Sn squared over n squared minus, let's say, Sn squared over k, for instance, then plus Sn squared over k minus Sk over k. So what I did here is simple. I just remove and add this Sn squared over k. I use the triangle inequality. And now, So it turns out that those two terms, we can prove that those two terms are small. So let's look at this one, for instance. So here we have the same denominator, k, which is of the order of n squared. Okay, k is between n squared and n plus 1 squared. So that's of the order of n squared. But if you look at the numerator here, you have basically a sum of the difference between sum of n squared term and k term of this sequence. But the difference between k and n squared is of the order of at most 2n. Okay? So what I'm saying here is that the difference between those two sums here, it's basically 2n of those terms. So that's of the order 2n, but we divide by a k that is of the order n squared. Okay, so that shows that this part, okay, again, sum of about like order of magnitude n terms, n random variable divided by n squared, so that's going to be bounded by a big O of 1 over n, so that means that that behaves in the worst case like 1 over n. What about this part? Well, here Sn squared is the sum of n squared of both terms, so that's of the order n squared. The numerator is of the order n squared. But let's look at the denominator now. So that's of the order of, so 1, I'm going to look at 1 over n squared minus 1 over k. Now, this is equal to k minus n squared. I should maybe look at absolute value here. So that's of the order of k minus n squared divided by k n squared. Okay, so again, same idea as here. K minus n squared is going to be less than n plus 1 squared minus n squared, which is equal to 2n. So this numerator here is, in the worst case, equal to 2n. But then we divide by n at the power 4. Okay, the k is larger than n squared, so that's n at the power 4. So we have here a 2n divided by n at the power 4. So eventually we have something. So we said 2n divided by n at the power 4. This one is at most of the order big O of 1 over n cubed. Okay, so that's only ignoring those Sn squared, but Sn squared is again the sum of n squared of those terms, so that's of the order again of n squared, and so we get that this quantity is of the order of at most n squared divided by n cubed, that gives you again a 1 over n. Okay, so eventually this like middle calculation shows you that this one is bounded by a big O of 1 over n also. So obviously when k goes to infinity and so n also goes to infinity, this also goes to infinity. And from that, we can conclude that this difference here is going to go to zero almost surely. Okay, so conclusion, I'm going to write it here. Conclusion of our calculation is that this goes to zero almost surely, and then by combining those two things we can conclude. Now we can say that again using once more the triangle inequality, we can say that sk over k minus mu is bounded by sk over k minus Sn squared over n squared plus Sn squared over n squared minus mu. And now we know that this quantity here that goes to zero almost surely, we know also that because this goes to mu almost surely, the difference here goes to zero almost surely. So eventually, indeed, this goes to zero almost surely. So, conclusion, we indeed have the strong law of large number, at least in the case where the variance is finite, we get that indeed Sn over n, or here I'm using sk over k, is going to converge almost surely to the expected value mu. To conclude this video, let me tell you a little bit now about the ergodic theorem. So the proof of this theorem is much more difficult than the proof of the law of large numbers, so I'm going to skip that, I'm not going to do this in this video, but at least I'm going to state the theorem and briefly after explain why this theorem is indeed an improvement of the strong law of large numbers. So, in the context of this theorem, we assume that we have a random variable x that is integrable, and we also have a function f going from omega to omega. We need two assumptions about this function f. First, this function is measure preserving, which means that for all event a, a and f minus 1 of a have the same probability. And second condition, f is ergodic, which means that if a is invariant by f, meaning that f minus 1 of a is equal to a, then a must be, let's say, some kind of trivial event that has either probability 0 or 1. So, if you have those ingredients, then you can, again, like in the case of the strong law of large number, prove that we have almost sure convergence to the expected value of x. But now, your empirical mean takes a different form. Now, the empirical mean is equal to 1 over n times the sum for I equals 1 to n of x of fi of omega. Here, fi means that you compose f by itself n times, I times. So, to explain why this theorem is indeed stronger than the strong law of large number, so let me write another result that, again, I'm not going to prove, but so that you see the spirit. So, let's assume that there exists indeed such a function f. Let's assume that there exists f. So, we said measure preserving. N ergodic okay such that well xi of omega is equal to x of fi of omega for all little omega in capital omega. So let's assume that we are given a sequence of random variable, xi, exactly like in the context of the strong law of large number, but instead of having this assumption of the random variable being independent and identically distributed, let's assume instead that for this sequence, well, there exists an integrable random variable x and a measure preserving an ergodic function f, such that for all omega, xi of omega can be written as x of fi of omega. So it turns out that the set of such sequence is exactly the set of sequence that are stationary. So I'm going to write that. So there exists such a function f and so on, if and only if, and I'm going to explain what is like what we mean by stationary, if and only if, the sequence xi is stationary okay so stationary means basically that if you take a block of let's say k of those random variables, k consecutive of those random variables, it doesn't matter where you take the block, you should not change the distribution of the block you took. And so that means that, okay, definition of stationarity for a sequence of random variables is the fact that x1, x2, and so on up to, let's say, xk, okay, is equal in distribution. I'm going to add a little d here to say equal in distribution to xn, xn plus 1, and so on, up to xn plus k minus 1, I guess, so that we have the right number, so xn plus k minus 1, and we want to have this for all n and k integer. So you see that if your sequence here is a sequence of independent identically distributed random variables, like in the context of the strong law of large number, so obviously this vector of k random variable is also going to have the same distribution as this vector here. So you see that independent identically distributed implies stationary. Okay. However, you can prove that there are sequences of random variables that are stationary, but you lack some kind of independence, but they are still stationary, but those random variables are not independent. They are not completely independent. So this shows in particular that you see here that the assumption of the strong law of large number independence and identically distributed implies stationarity, but the converse is not true. And so that tells you that in fact the ergodic theorem shows in fact that the strong law of large number is again true for sequences that are only stationary, which is in fact a weaker assumption than the actual assumption of the strong law of large number.